Welcome back. Now it's time to take a look at the first topic of this edition of The Breakfast Show. Now we're going to be discussing Egypt's economy. Now, if we're going to discuss Egypt's economy, we have to analyze the current situation of the economy and also expectations for the economy in the upcoming period, or the vision of analysts and experts regarding the economy. And if we have to do that, we have to base this based on a historical point of view. We have to take a look back in history, Egypt's economy, and the ups and downs that the Egyptian economy has been through. In order to do that, we're very much honored and delighted to have with us here in the studio Mr. Mahmoud Nabil Ibrahim. He is an international banking sector sector expert, and also the great grandson of Talat Harb Pasha. Talat Harb is one of the people who laid the foundation of the Egyptian economy by establishing the first national bank here in Egypt. It's an honor having you with us here, Mr. Mahmoud. Thank you very much for coming. Very good morning to you.
Well, first of all, good morning, and thank you very much for inviting me to your program.
And first, I want to ask you an important question. As you are the grandson of Talat Harb Pasha, what are the important stages in the history of Egypt's economy?
Well, looking back, because one of my passion is history, and looking back at the history of modern Egypt, I could identify three renaissances distinct, and they do have two common traits, the three of them. First of all, they ended up, and they marked the end of a totally obsolete system, and obnoxious as well. And the second one being, there is a cycle of 100 years, plus or minus 10, between each Renaissance and the other. So starting with the first one, I would mention Muhammad Ali, who took power in 1805, that was culminated later on in 1811, with the famous massacre of the Mamluk in the citadel. So that was the first one. And during Muhammad Ali, it was the first cooperation, real cooperation between East and West, because he asked Colonel Sèvres, who was in Napoleon's army and participated in the famous Battle of Waterloo in 1815, to come to Egypt in 1816 with a very clear mission to create a modern Egyptian army based on Napoleonic tactics. And this culminated in a great victory for Egyptian armies in 1839, in the famous Battle of Nezib against the Ottoman army. The Egyptian troops were something like 45,000 facing 80,000 Ottoman army, and the Ottoman army was even supported by Prussian officers. And after this, the road to Istanbul was open, but the superpowers at the time, Russia, Prussia, and England, stopped him and allowed him to have Egypt for himself as well as for his dynasty later on. And the second one, we take 100 years from 1811 to 1911. Talat Harb started promoting for the idea of creating the National Bank, that was founded in 1920, and he had the vision of cohesiveness. So he invited the different communities, religious communities, to be on the board of the Bank Mis, to participate in the capital as well. And at the time, the capital was 80,000 Egyptian pounds at the time. So God knows what it would be like now. So we had Kattawi Basha and Sikurel from the famous store. Sikurel were on the board of Bank Mis, and some Coptic like those and Muslims as well. And Bank Misr marked the end. So with Muhammad Ali, it was the end of the Mamluk regime. Bank Misr was the end of the monopoly of foreigners on the Egyptian economy, on banking, on the industry. And it was taken from the German system of Grosse Bank, meaning creating a bank and around it creating like a conglomerate of different industries. So he created Studio Misr, the different, the nice black and white movies of the time, Misrair, which became Egyptair and still existing. Misr in 1937, he created Misr for Oil and Gas, which is now EGPC, Egyptian General Petroleum Authority. So, I mean, the companies are still running. And and he had this kind of vision. So that was the second Renaissance, and I would say the third Renaissance would be June 30, 2013, and I insist it was a revolution. It was not at all a coup d'etat, just by seeing the tens of men that hit the street and manifesting against an obsolete and obnoxious regime. So these are the three Renaissances in modern Egypt. And now looking, taking, after this habit, taking a look at Egypt next. So we have a conference coming on March just to attract investors to Egypt. I read in the newspaper that there would be something like $20 billion allocated to as seed money for Egyptian investments. That would be the participation of Egypt in these investments. Well, my hope is that this will not be diluted right, left, and center in different projects. I am for focus and concentration, which are sine qua non condition for success, meaning that we need to focus on one national project that would comprehend most of the different dimensions of a futuristic Egypt. So my idea for this,
we have the Suez Canal project. It has been inaugurated.
Project, it's very encouraging, but it's not a project that would really take, it's excellent, and I 100% endorse it, because it will create immediate cash flow, it's realistic, so we need to keep the momentum moving forward. So the best thing to do would be, in my opinion, that would cover different dimensions of the Egyptian economy, would be the creation of a new capital completely. Because by new capital, first of all, Dubai is a real success story. We don't need to compete with Dubai. They should come in, and they've reached saturation in terms of population. In a few years, we'll be breaking the 100 million threshold in terms of population. So then we need to create a joint venture with them, with other Gulf-friendly states like Kuwait, Saudi Arabia, and not stop at this. I mean, this capital should be a capital not only for the Middle East, but a cosmopolitan capital. We need to go, in my career as an international banker, I had the chance of visiting San Jose, for instance, in Silicon Valley, South Korea, and we need to take some examples of these cities and try to implement it in Egypt. So we must have like a roadshow visiting most of the developed countries and inviting them to create their own districts in Egypt. For instance, Seoul, South Korea, half of the population is concentrated in Seoul. The population is 50 million, so Seoul is 25 million only. So we can, I mean, I've been there, I mean, it's really sad to see the Egyptians just going to work, taking 2 hours, and then you ask them to be productive. I mean, this has to stop. I mean,
okay. Now, so sir, based on your vision,
yes,
you're saying that there has to be a capital in the future, and we have to gather momentum and all participate.
Absolutely.
Apart from the great Suez project.
Yeah.
Since you are an international banker and you are international economic expert, now what I have seen is that some countries have focused on certain sectors. For example, India focused on the IT business.
Yeah.
Korea focused on the car industry and the automobile industry. Japan focused on electronics.
Yes.
For example, what, in your own opinion, would be the sector? Should there be a particular sector that Egypt can focus on, such as oil, for example, or mineral resources, or tourism? Or should it diverse its, or the diversification would actually waste?
Well, I'm really glad you mentioned this point, because I was coming to it. So we need to do a roadshow, visit most of the developed countries, and we would ask China, for instance, to build a Chinese district, the US, a US district, Korea, a Korean district, France as well.
Across Egypt.
Across Egypt. So we'd have the American district, the Chinese district, and we'd ask these countries to provide the universities, hospitals, schools, and multinationals to provide, making them like a mini China, little China, little Italy, little France. And there would come these multinationals, and when I visited Silicon Valley, the director of these multinationals, what would they do? They would go to schools and universities, teach students about the latest technology. So once a student graduates, he would have two options. Either join the multinational, because they would have a file on every student, and this way you are modernizing your education, you are creating a job opportunity for him.
And competition.
And competition, exactly.
Competition.
And this model would really encourage workshops and encourage teamwork. So and another venue for the students once they graduate would be to create their own startup with seed money from angel investors who are the multinationals.
That would be the incubation or the entrepreneurship?
Exactly, for entrepreneurship. So this way, through this new capital, you would solve a great deal of the education problem and a great deal of the job problem.
Okay, sir. Do you see the Egyptian market is attractive enough to investors in the coming period? And how do you see amendments to the investment law?
Well, first of all, I would say not yet. We do have the raw material, and I think it's for now it's work in progress. The government is working very hard towards this direction.
Investments?
Yes, to encourage investors.
And the move and problems facing investors.
Exactly, yeah.
How can we do this?
Because first of all, I heard that lots of investors bought pieces of land according to official contracts, and now they told them, no, you have to give us more money,
yeah,
because